Hey, this is Joe from Home Studio Corner. Let's talk about your room. One thing we all have in common, regardless of the type of music that we make or the type of gear that we use, we are all working in some sort of room, an enclosed, oftentimes rectangular space. We're not in outer space. We're not outdoors. We're down here on planet Earth in some sort of enclosed area, and that affects the sound. Let me show you what I'm talking about, and then I'll show you exactly how I like to set up my rooms for recording and for mixing. The first thing you're going to see in this next clip is me in the next room over that doesn't have any treatment, and then we'll jump right here into this room in this position so you can hear the difference that just the room makes on the sound itself. Big empty room, testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. My studio space, testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3. Even with an iPhone recording, that's a pretty big difference.
Testing.
Why does this matter? Well, first, if you're recording in a room like that, you're going to record the sound of that room every time you press the record button. That can add up over time and can make your recording sound weird, funky, or just not professional. Secondly, when you try to mix in a room that has way too much sound to it, you're going to have a hard time hearing the mix accurately, which means you're not going to know if your mix sounds good or not because there's so much room sound hitting your ears as well as the sound from the speakers. The goal here isn't to soundproof your room. The goal is to turn the room down so you can hear what's happening. Step one, use carpet and or rugs in your studio space. The easiest way to start taming that big reflective reverberant sound is to put down carpet or rugs in your studio. I've had studios with hardwood floors. I've had studios like this with kind of a fake laminate floor. And I've had studios with just straight carpet. I always put rugs down if it's a hardwood floor because that wood is the sound will bounce off the floor and go to the ceiling and just go back and forth. We're trying to minimize some of those reflections, and a really easy way to do that and fairly inexpensive way is to just lay down a few rugs. Just by doing that, you'll notice the room starts to sound a little bit cleaner. Step number two, put absorption at the mirror points to the left and right-hand side of your mix position. That means if I was to put a mirror on the wall over here to my right and to my left, the place where I would look in the mirror and see my speakers is the place where I want some absorption. Not just a tiny piece, I like to put big honking panels to either side to absorb any sound that might come out of the speakers and try to bounce off of that side wall. If you've never done that before, that simple change, you'll notice your mixes suddenly sound more detailed and they sound wider. It's weird, but the sound bouncing off the side walls and hitting your ear messes with the sound you're hearing direct. Just putting up some panels to the left and right will tighten up your space, and it'll tighten up any recordings that you're doing in this same space. I record a lot of guitar and vocals sitting right here, and I'm right between these two panels, which means I get a pretty clean sound because none of the sound bounces off those side walls and comes back. Number three, put some absorption on the back wall. As you can see back behind me on the far wall, I've got three absorption panels, and those are designed to absorb some of the sound that comes out of my speakers, goes all the way down the room, and wants to bounce back to my ear. This absorbs some of that for the same reason as before, to allow me to hear the speakers more clearly and not as much room. Now, I could easily put the absorption back behind my speakers as well, but I only had enough to put them in one spot, and I felt that there was more benefit to having it a little deader out here than dead behind my big old 27-inch monitor where the sound is kind of trapped anyway. And then here's a bonus step four, use bass traps and extra absorption if you can swing it. So I have two big, huge bass traps in the corners of my room, and those tend to just help absorb some of the extra low-end frequencies that bounce around the room, and they also do just some normal absorption as well. As far as the walls themselves, what I try to do is first have the mirror points taken care of, and then I try to space it out to where no surface of this cube is facing another bare wall as much as possible. So, back wall has treatment, this wall behind you does not. At least one of them does, so sound bouncing gets absorbed that way and doesn't bounce back. Okay? Sound going this way gets absorbed both here and there because that's a really important spot. Sound that bounces on the floor goes up to the ceiling. There's no treatment on the ceiling, but the carpet and the rugs on the floor will absorb that. The only vulnerable spot in my room is this wall here and that wall there. Those are both fairly bare, and it breaks that rule of having two bare walls facing each other. but I don't do any recording back there. And if I did, I could just move some panels back to give it a little more of a dead sound so the sound isn't bouncing off of those side walls. Ideally, I'd have a few more panels made and put some there. But as you can see, I'm operating on a fairly minimal setup that I've used. If you've watched my videos for years, I've had these same panels in the last several houses that I've lived in, and I put them in different positions just based on the room itself, but I generally try to follow these same principles. Go back and watch some of my old videos, look at where my treatment is. For the most part, I'm following these same rules. Rug on the floor, mirror points, front and or back wall, and then bass traps and extra treatment if you have it. And final piece of advice, whenever you're recording in your space, if it's not perfect, my space isn't perfect, think about your microphone as a flashlight. The closer I get the flashlight to the source, the less of the room I see. So imagine we're in the complete dark and this is my vocal. If I put the microphone here, the light will shine on my vocal, but also shine on that far wall. So if you reverse that, if it's a microphone, the microphone's gonna pick up some of the room sound in addition to my vocal. If I move the microphone closer, guess what? It's seeing more hand, less wall, which means the microphone's gonna pick up more vocal, less room. Now, the trade-off there is as you get closer to the source, you typically pick up more low frequencies, so you might end up with less room and more boom. Pretty cute, right? All right, that's it for this video. How do you go about treating your room? Leave a comment below and let us know. And if you're into mixing and you haven't checked out my 5-step mix guide, it's still free and it's waiting for you at 5stepmix.com. Go check it out. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one.